church plant breakfast meeting scheduled for 8 o'clock next Saturday morning. Want to emphasize that. This is open to anyone who is interested in getting more information about our church plant. You may have heard of it and think, that's a neat idea. I think I might want to be a part of a brand new church plant. This breakfast is for you. That may not at all be your case. You may just have heard about it and wonder what we're doing. This breakfast is for you. If you want more information about the church plant, be here next Saturday morning, 8 o'clock. This is not limited to members only. Anyone who wants to more information, be here at 8 o'clock, get a good breakfast, and learn more about the church plant. The single most contentious issue that bothered the first century church was about circumcision. If there is any New Testament topic that does not resonate with people today, that's probably a front runner, circumcision. We study and debate a lot of things in churches today. We even divide over a lot of doctrinal issues, some of which may even justify some spiritual separation. But circumcision as a religious topic generally doesn't present any great problem for us and doesn't have any great interest for us either. One reason why we aren't more troubled by things related to circumcision today is that the subject was so thoroughly addressed in the first century church. In Acts chapter 10, for example, Peter received a revelation from God showing that he had opened the door to the Gentiles. Peter followed the lead of that vision and offered the gospel and full fellowship privileges to Gentiles without them, the males, needing to be circumcised. In Acts chapter 15, there was a big meeting in Jerusalem that was designed to put a stop to brethren going out from Jerusalem and teaching that Gentiles had to be circumcised before they could be admitted to the church. Now, that meeting didn't put a total end to the debate, but it took a strong stand on the issue anyway. And then the Apostle Paul wrote two letters that focused heavily on the circumcision issue. The longer of the two was the book of Romans. The shorter version of that dealt with the same basic theme or the same basic message was Galatians. So whether we are highly interested in the topic of circumcision or not, we should acknowledge that the topic occupies a prominent role in that portion of Scripture, that portion of God's Word that we call the New Testament. That is because the importance of the topic, and Paul saw this very well, the importance of the topic was more than a simple matter of having the male converts be circumcised or not. This debate was not limited to how one becomes a Christian. More fundamentally, it was about how a person is saved. By what force? By what power? By what truth? It determined not only how to become a Christian, but how one lived as a Christian. It even determined who you could share a meal with and who you could call your brother in Christ. So today we may not often debate the merits or lack thereof of circumcision, but we certainly want to know by what power and by what truth we are saved. If Paul's opponents on this subject had prevailed in the early church, the gospel would have been offered to Jews only and to those who would become Jews. Salvation would not have been preached as through Christ alone, but through Moses and the Old Testament law and Christ. Over the next couple of months, I want to have three or four lessons drawn from Paul's letter to the Galatians. Paul opens the letter by addressing his audience. Paul, an apostle, not from men nor through man, but through Jesus Christ, the God and God the Father, who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren who are with me, to the churches of Galatia. As is often the case in Bible study, there is some debate over just where this Galatia was, where exactly were the boundaries, if there were exact boundaries, which towns and which churches were included in that. Most likely, it was roughly the same area as where Paul and Barnabas went on their first missionary journey, or roughly that general area. In Acts chapter 13, God called Paul and Barnabas and sent them to go out traveling around and preaching the gospel as they went. They first went to Cyprus, probably because Barnabas was originally from Cyprus. But then they moved into Asia Minor, where we call Turkey today, and a part of Asia Minor was called Galatia. After a brief stop in the port city of Perga, they moved to the interior and arrived at a town called Antioch in Pisidia, not to be confused with Antioch in Syria, where they had been when God called them for this journey. Beginning in Acts chapter 13, and around verse 16, we have an account of the first sermon that Paul preached in the synagogue of Antioch of Pisidia. It's very much like Peter's sermon in Acts 2, a lot like Stephen's sermon in Acts 7. Paul summarized the history of Israel and then arrived at the main topic of Jesus Christ crucified and risen. The latter part of Paul's sermon in the synagogue of Antioch provides a close parallel with the opening verses and with the general theme of Galatians. So I want to read in Galatians, or in Acts chapter 13. We'll begin around verse 32, and we'll get down through verse 39. So it's a fairly long reading. Listen carefully or follow along in your Bibles. "And we declare to you glad tidings, that promise which was made to the fathers. God has fulfilled this for us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus. As it is also written in the second psalm, 'You are my son, today I have begotten you.' And that he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption. He has spoken thus, 'I will give you the sure mercies of David.' Therefore, he also says in another psalm, 'You will not allow your Holy One to see corruption.' For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell asleep, was buried with his fathers, and saw corruption. But he whom God raised up saw no corruption." And then especially these last two verses. "Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sins. And by him, everyone who believes is justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses." Notice that he mentions the resurrection of Jesus several times in those verses. He states that forgiveness of sins comes through Jesus and not through the law of Moses. He specifies that faith in Jesus brings a justification that wasn't even possible under the law of Moses. Those themes are also the major themes of Paul's letter to the Galatians. The Galatian letter was not written for one congregation, but for several congregations in that area of Asia Minor, sort of like the book of Revelation that was written to a group of churches in a general area. The same area may even have overlapped with the churches concerned in the Galatian letter. But the Galatian churches were churches that Paul and Barnabas had started. And Paul wrote the letter because someone was going around through those same churches preaching that regardless of what Paul said, if you wanted to be saved, You had to obey the law of Moses, plus believe in Jesus. Accepting circumcision then affirmed the idea that a person was agreeing to keep the law and be saved by doing so. By contrast, the gospel offered salvation to everyone, Jew or Gentile, who would place his faith in the sacrifice of Jesus. We are the kind of Christians we are today because the message of Galatians prevailed at that time. This was not a peripheral doctrinal issue. It was a core principle of the gospel. In Paul's greeting to the Galatian Christians, he wished them two things. We find in verse 3, "Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ." These may sound like a simple, standard, polite way that you're expected to open a letter back then, but these two ideas of grace and peace play an important role in Paul's message. A few verses later, down in verse 7, Paul will mention some who trouble you and want to pervert the gospel. Misunderstanding the ideas of grace and peace was at the foundation of this perverted gospel that required circumcision. Paul's opponents were disturbing the peace of these Christians by distorting God's grace. And the same problems rob Christians today of the peace that God wants us to have. There are some New Testament ideas that are difficult to understand and keep in balance. We're aware of that. And we do ourselves a favor if we admit that we struggle to figure them out. We hurt ourselves when we pretend that they're easier to understand than they really are, because then we don't study them as deeply as we should. One of them that we study fairly frequently is the balance between faith and works. We know that we're not saved by the goodness or even the number of our good works. We're saved by the sacrifice of Jesus. That's a theme that is discussed in many places, including in Galatians. But it's easy to get faith and works out of balance in one direction or another. If we distort the idea of salvation by faith, we might wrongly assume that there's no obligation to live righteous lives. All we have to do is believe. I believe, therefore I'm saved. And if I sin, it doesn't matter because, well, I still believe. In the New Testament, genuine faith produces righteous living. It doesn't replace it. The tension between grace and peace is not exactly the same as that between faith and works, but there are still some similarities. In this letter, Paul clearly teaches we're saved by grace. With the law, or without the law, without grace, no one could be saved. It was important that Old Testament Jews living in Old Testament times obeyed the law. But no one could keep the law perfectly enough to force God to save them. For example, obeying the law, most of the time, 99.99% of the time, would not save them from the few times when they didn't obey the law. Sin was sin, and only God's grace could remove even the tiniest sin. One distortion of that concept came from the people who were wanting to require continued obedience to the law of Moses, and especially circumcision. And because of that emphasis on the old law, they couldn't imagine God saving anyone who wasn't a Jew according to the law. Maybe this Jesus was really crucified. Maybe a person had to believe in him, but he still had to be a Jew to benefit from God's grace. Correcting that conviction was the great challenge of anyone who presented the gospel to Jews in the first century. Jews of the first century simply had a hard time accepting the idea that a person could receive God's favor, God's grace, without passing through the doorway of Judaism. And they were troubling Gentiles who believed in Christ, who submitted to Christ, but who hadn't gone through that doorway. So Paul says, grace and peace from God and from Jesus, who gave himself for our sins. The law may have revealed our sins, but it did not forgive them. Today, our problem with grace and peace might be a little bit different. It might take a different form. Paul is not trying to produce complacency among Christians. He is not telling his readers that they could be at peace because of God's grace and that they could go ahead and sin all they wanted because grace would take care of everything. That's not where Paul was going. He was writing to promote peace based on grace and to keep them from being troubled by people who wanted to add something to grace. The problem we have might be on the other end of this. How many Christians beat themselves up or allow themselves to be beaten up because they're not good enough? They don't do enough. We don't have to look far to find some. We probably have some in this room. And these are not the people who are trying to abuse God's grace. These are people who are very aware of it, very thankful for it. These are the tender-hearted ones who are overwhelmed that God's grace would forgive their sins. But they still feel guilty because they know they don't deserve God's grace. But that's the very nature of grace. It's something that we don't deserve. We didn't deserve it when we were baptized, and we still don't deserve it. Paul wants his readers to be thankful for God's grace, and by trusting God's grace, Paul wants them to have peace. Now, I said peace, not complacency. We know that we are imperfect sinners saved by God's grace. To think otherwise is to lack humility. But we are not to be tormented by that same humility and that same awareness of unworthiness. God's grace is supposed to produce peace, not more feelings of guilt. The core thought of first century preaching was the crucified and risen Christ. You can go back to the book of Acts and look at the various sermons that are recorded in the book of Acts. It might be Peter's sermon on Pentecost. It might be Stephen's sermon that got him stoned to death. It might be Peter talking to the family of Cornelius. It might be Paul preaching to the philosophers of Athens. If they were speaking to a Jewish audience, they spent more time on Jewish history and mentioned Abraham and Moses and Egyptian bondage and things like that. If they were speaking to Gentile audiences, they talked more about the universal and sovereign God who created all that is. But all of those lessons, in all of those lessons, they eventually got to the main point. And the main point was Christ crucified and risen. And there may be several reasons for that emphasis, but the main reason is that salvation is dependent totally on the crucified and risen Christ. As Paul pointed out to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 1:23, both Jews and Gentiles argued against that idea. For the Jews, a crucified Christ was a stumbling block. For the Gentiles, it was sheer foolishness. But they all had to deal with it. Jews couldn't substitute law-keeping for it. Gentiles couldn't bypass it. It was Christ crucified and risen, or it was nothing. There was no alternative. If the law could save, then Jesus didn't need to come to earth and die. Later in Galatians, Paul will return to the subject of the old law and the role that it played in God's plan. And it played an important role. That role was to lead us to Christ. Galatians 3, verse 24, he wrote, "Therefore the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. We are not saved by the law, nor by keeping the law. We are saved because Jesus gave himself for our sins and God raised him from the dead." Now, we know that. You know that. Don't want to imply that you don't know that. I don't want to insult your faith or your intelligence by suggesting that I'm teaching you something you don't already know. But that basic truth must remain front and center as Paul goes on to deal with the various problems facing the Galatian Christians. It is not an accident that he mentioned both the resurrection and the sacrifice of Jesus in the opening verses of this letter. But the main idea that I want to emphasize this morning is Paul's statement in verse 4 about the purpose of Christ giving himself. In verse 4, he goes on to say, "Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil age according to the will of our God and Father." The word "deliver" in this verse is more emphatic than most of our translations suggest. As long as a Jew was satisfied with his spiritual condition under the law, it was hard to get him to step over that stumbling block of the cross. Jesus had a revealing discussion with the Pharisees recorded in John chapter 8, beginning in verse 30. This is the occasion when Jesus tried to encourage them when he said, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." But they answered and said, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been in bondage to anyone." They threw it back in his face. And Jesus then answered in verse 34, "Whoever commits sin is a slave to sin." As long as they maintain their claim of not being in any kind of bondage, they would have a hard time accepting Christ. When we use the word "deliver," though, it sounds a lot more ordinary. UPS will deliver a package for us. Now, that might be good news if it's on time and it isn't damaged, but it's hardly gospel good news. In baseball, the pitcher delivers the pitch. Maybe more significant, the OBGYN delivers the pregnant woman's baby. But the NIV, and I'm guessing that Philip was reading from the NIV, uses the word "rescue" in this verse, and that possibly catches our attention a little bit better than the word "deliver" does. It's the same word that Stephen used back in Acts 7 in his synagogue sermon when he said that God delivered Joseph out of all his troubles. Joseph was a slave in Egypt and had a lot of problems, and God rescued him. It was a major deliverance. And then later in that same sermon, Stephen added that God came down to deliver Israel from oppression in Egypt. The Exodus was a rescue operation. That's what Paul is writing about in this verse. Christ gave himself to rescue us. Now, modern Christians have been conditioned enough, possibly by the New Testament, that this idea maybe makes more sense to us, or more easily makes sense to us than it would have then. Paul was certainly saying that Jews living under the law and practicing circumcision needed to be rescued. But sometimes, even to us, salvation can seem like little more than a theological concept for us to learn, rather than the act of being rescued from serious bondage. The gospel of salvation by the crucified Jesus has little appeal to someone who doesn't think he needs to be rescued. And that describes most of our modern Western world. When we were missionaries in Belgium, American Christians would often ask me, what is the greatest obstacle we face to spreading the gospel? Was it Catholicism? Or was it government restrictions? And my answer was always that the greatest obstacle was materialism and indifference to the gospel. People were consumed with making their way in an affluent society. They might have wanted to be rescued from some of the demands of modern living, but they didn't turn to the gospel to be rescued from this present evil age. And unless that changed, there was little incentive for accepting the gospel. And that's a concept that's worthy of our reflection. How do we present the gospel as a rescue from this present evil age? Well, first we have to realize and help others realize that we indeed need to be rescued. And second, we have to realize that we need to be rescued from this present evil age. And we will not be rescued from this present evil age by things that are a part of this present evil age. We won't be rescued from this present evil age by a better job and more money. We won't be rescued from this present evil age by the outcome of Tuesday's election. And as Christians, we need to live in a way that shows that we don't expect to be rescued by such things. And the phrase, this present evil age, also deserves some of our attention. Paul wasn't making a comment on how bad things were in the first century compared to some other moments in history. For Paul, the world at its best was still this present evil age. This is a world where the greatest problem is sin, and things won't be better until we are rescued from sin. That deliverance isn't achieved through better housing or saving the environment. It isn't achieved by breakthroughs in medical science that allow us to live even longer in this present evil age. Christ delivers us from this present evil age by forgiving our sins and offering eternal life in heaven. A proper response to Christ must have some understanding of what kind of bondage His sacrifice is intended to deliver us from. It is bondage to sin, to this world, and to the things of this world. I know that many times today, the idea of being set free from the rules of the Old Testament is construed to mean that the New Testament system doesn't have any commands that we have to obey. That is not at all Paul's message. Later in the letter, he makes it very clear that people benefiting from God's grace will control their fleshly desires. Spirit-led lives will be lives that allow the fruit of the Spirit to grow: love, joy, peace, long-suffering, and all the rest. Another distortion is that lifestyle, at least in certain areas, that might matter, but religious doctrines don't matter. But just be a good person and do good works type concept. But the entire Galatian letter is built on the idea that lifestyle is determined by doctrines, such as teachings about grace and even something about circumcision. Paul wasn't giving permission to sin because grace would forgive anyway. And he wasn't saying that a sufficient level of obedience would save us. He was presenting the grace of God that removes the sin that we couldn't remove ourselves. He was offering the peace that comes by trusting the power of Christ's sacrifice over any system of rules. And he was calling for lives that were proper responses to all of the above. Christians are expected to live righteous lives, Because God's grace enables us to live righteous lives. But we don't get into Christ and receive the forgiveness of sins by the quality of our great obedience. Our sins are forgiven when we trust the power of the crucifixion and the promise of God to forgive those who will believe and be baptized. Believe in Jesus, the Son of God who died, rose from the dead to rescue you from sin. Turn away from sin because it's incompatible with being a rescued person. Be baptized and let God fulfill His promise to wash your sins away. If you want to be baptized, if you want the church to pray for you, encourage you to live as a forgiven person should, let us know. Let's stand and sing. You can come if you care to.